astrally form may become absent or reversed. So these are the four pictures where we usually see normal umbilica. The first picture is which is absolutely normal. This is like high resistance, which can be like an predictor, early predictors, or an early changes of placental insufficiency. And this is absent. This is like mild, moderate, moderate affection of the placental insufficiencies. And reversal, yes, it's a time to take the decisions. So again, the next important predictor is middle cerebral artery. This is also if the index is less than 5% is considered as an early stage of intrauterine growth restriction. And the nadir of MCA-PA is reached to 14 days or more before the fetal compromise. So it's very important to monitor the MCAs also. And it informs, CPMC usually informs the existence of any brain vasodilation or any other hypoxic changes which are going in the fetus. So these are the MCA forms, waveforms which you usually see. This is absolutely normal and there is an increased flow. We can clearly see the increased flow in this. So other more important predictors is like cerebroplacental ratios. Very good diagnostic index, more sensitive index. And the perinatal, it is more important to monitor the perinatal outcomes of the outcomes along with the umbilical arteries and if we detect the cerebroplacental ratios are being affected, neurological behavior of problems can arise to the children even at 18 months of age after the delivery. The doctor's Venus says it's the strongest single Doppler parameter. Absent or reversed velocities, usually they are more associated with perinatal mortality independently. And we can take it as a guidance to help us to deliver the babies. So these are the ductus venosus normals. And these are reversal of the ductus venosus, which is clearly seen. And this is a beautiful indication. The protocols which we usually see is like uterine artery plus cerebroplacental ratios and estimated fetal weight. Three can be taken into the considerations. If we see from the mild to it is usually they are predicted as a mild, moderate, and severe. In the mild changes, CPR is less than 5th percentile, and uterine artery resistance is been increasing, and PCA is falling down less than. We need to monitor the babies accordingly. Like yeah, we'll come down to flow chart what we have to do the next if we see the changes. And what about the severe placental restrictions? Usually ductus venosus absence or it is can be reversed. And even the same holds with the umbilical artery also. Severe forms and acidosis, you can see that significant changes in the ductus venosus. Reversal also can occur. High suspicions of acidosis or high risk to the death is very clearly predicted with ductus venosus. So, and one more important, as we already discussed, during the NT scans, we usually do the double markers. I mean, nowadays we are doing the first trimester quadruple markers, and which is measuring the both hormones. And this, along with this, the Dopplers, if we combined, we can clearly predict the risk of IUGR and risk of preeclampsia by taking the maternal age into considerations. So generally, we know after birth, how the babies of IUGR are being diagnosed. They'll be always 600 grams below the estimated weight. And length is usually unaffected. Head circumference will be relatively larger in asymmetrical IUGRs. Babies, but generally, if it is asymmetrical, they'll be active, normal. They can cry. They open the eyes and the reflexes also will be normal. But the skin will be dry and wrinkled and subcutaneous fat will be really less. We indirectly call as an old man look. And plantar traces also will be well defined. So coming to complications, so it is divided into maternal and fetal. So maternal, we usually won't expect much. Fetal, during the antenatal period, it's very important. If very severe oligohydramnias are there, it may lead to cord compression and leads to fetal distress and fetal death. And intranatally, hypoxia. During the process of delivery, hypoxia and acidosis do occur, which we can monitor through the NSTs or the fetal scalp samplings. So after birth, it can be immediate complications or late complications with severe IUGRs. Now, we know about that respiratory distress syndromes will be more in this IUGRs, and asphyxia can occur anytime. Hypoglycemic changes, meconium aspiration syndromes, and they may land up with microcoagulation profiles can be dearranged. Hypothermia can occur, pulmonary hemorrhages, intraventricular hemorrhages and hyperviscosity thrombosis and the necrotizing enterocolitis for the intestines and electrolyte imbalance and phosphatemias. So multi-organ failure and perinatal morbidity and mortality, yeah, nowadays, because maybe because of the technology what we are having, we're not seeing much, but yeah, it has to be mentioned with neglected or not if any other maternal complications are very severe. So what about the late complications? So symmetrical growth retarded babies are likely to grow slowly after the birth. Asymmetrical, they may catch up the weight very easily. Maybe effectively they can turn back to their normal weight. And retarded neurological and intellectual developments in few infancies is usually seen. But when it comes to any congenital infections or congenital abnormalities or chromosomal defects, we may see the worst prognosis. And there will be increased risk in the adult age, increase if they are born IUGRs. In case if it is like IUGRs, in the adult ages, maybe they may land up with obesity, hypertension, diabetes, coronary heart diseases do occur. The most important thing is in adult ages, they may have the chances of developing renal vascular hypertensions. As we discussed, maternal complications is not because of IUGR. It might be because of the maternal other complications like eclampsia or any cardiac diseases or any renal diseases. So coming to the management, we can divide into the mothers into like if it is a constitutionally small, we may not much interfere with them. But if it is symmetrical IUGRs, depending upon the anomalies, if it is like very badly having any structural defects, any other diseases or genetic syndromes, yeah, sometimes we become helpless. But when it is like maternal causes which can be corrected, and if it treated at least till term, we can pull the babies and we can properly deliver the babies. So, but generally, if we detect the early in the pregnancies without any Doppler changes or scans, the lifestyle changes, sometimes it is usually helpful, though there are no proofs to prove it. Adequate bed rest in the left lateral position, which increases circulations, and correct malnutrition by the balanced diet, like high rich protein diet, excess of 300 excess calories has to be taken, planned excess calories. And any complicating factors like any medications has to be started, it has to be started. And lifestyle changes like smoking and alcohol has to be quit. And if we see any Doppler changes during the NT scans or early detection of any intrauterine increase in the resistance, then we have to start the low dose aspirins. Depending upon the severity of the resistance, we can start 75 or 150. So are any maternal conditions or prior histories of any hypertension or thrombotic diseases, any prior histories of preeclampsia, early onset of icosapent also is helpful. So during antepartum evaluations, serial growth scans, as we discussed, growth scans are very good indicators for us to detect the IUGRs. And fetal kick counts, we need to counsel the mother how to follow the kick counts. And depending upon the severity, the NSTs and biophysical profiles and Dopplers has to be done. And medical management, I feel this is the most helpful for all the obstetricians who are practicing. And say, as we discuss the pathophysiology about the RVS deformities and vasoobstrictions, we need something which going to nicely vasodilate as well as to prevent the placental insufficiency changes. So there's the L-arginine, which is an indicator, which is an very good nitrous oxide synthetase initiator, so we can start L-arginines along with the combination of magnesiums, which acts as a beautiful vasodilators. So easily available as a sachets, single per day, which is started from second trimester, always gives us a very good results. So when it comes to time of delivery, so it all depends upon the fetal abnormalities and duration, gestational age of the pregnancies, and degree of growth restrictions, and associated complicated factors, obstetric histories and obstetric complications or any contraindications. Main important thing is for before delivering IUGR, the availability of NICUs. So if we see this flow chart, which briefs us how to manage the IUGRs, first we need to exclude, as we discussed, with the scans and all congenital deformities and all. And we need to keep the tools ready for fetal monitoring like CTG, biophysical scans and Dopplers. If the pregnancy is less than 37 weeks, and or if the pregnancy is greater than 37 weeks, there is no point in postponing even from mild to severe. Mild to severe IUGRs, we need to plan for the delivery. If it is less than 37 weeks, it can be divided into mild IUGRs and severe IUGRs. If it comes to mild IUGRs, as we discussed, we can give the sufficient rest to the mothers, folic acid replacement, hydration, and L-arginines and magnesium sulfate replacements. And in any complications, if she is having like diabetes, it has to be under control. She should not be overcorrecting her diet. and hypertension, she has to take all antihypertensive medications and fetal monitoring. We need, our goal is to just to monitor till 37 weeks and then deliver. If any changes are observed, then we need to go ahead with the further decision making. So if it is severe IUGRs, it's always a challenge for us to see the, to protect the baby from prematurity as well as the dismaturity. First thing is, if no equipment, like important thing is NICU availability. In vitro transfer is always preferred. If acute center is there, fetal surveillance has to be done. And the reassuring, if it is fetus is reassuring and the Dopplers are being better, every weekly Dopplers has to be done till it is get rearranged or the pregnancy reaches 37 weeks. If it is non-reassuring, we can check the maturity of the lungs. If matured, we try to deliver as soon as possible. If not matured, steroid prophylaxis we need to give, and magnesium sulfate prophylaxis for neuroprotection, which is very important to reduce the intraventricular hemorrhages, and then deliver. So I didn't concentrate much on the doses of steroids and the magnesium sulfate. If in discussions, if anybody needs, we can discuss further. So this is a beautiful chart. Somehow I usually remember this whenever I see an IUGR patient, but a bit complicated, but three things if we remember that is going to be very useful for us to decide when to deliver the babies. So first thing is, if the baby is around small for gestation, you can, see, if it is 40 weeks, greater than 40 weeks, there is no point. We usually plan for the delivery irrespective of the IUGR severity. And if the child, if it is just like 37, or if it is 36 to 37, in fact, we can say we check all those things. We check estimated fetal weight and the CPRs and MCA pulse, MCA and umbilical artery Dopplers. And in case if we see any mild changes in this, all the changes are mild, we can admit the patient and we can monitor it after 12 weeks and postpone till 37 and deliver. Stage 2, in case if it is greater than 34 weeks and if we see artery, umbilical arteries Dopplers are absent or reversed, yes, we need to deliver. Even if it is greater than 30 weeks, if we see stage 3 like ductal venosus changes or reversed umbilical arteries, no point, we have to deliver. The most challenging time, that 26 weeks, if absent or reversed ductus venosus and any pathological decreased variabilities, if they both are seen, we need to terminate the pregnancy and we need to counsel parents for the NICU admissions and further management. And this is a very simple chart I usually remember in my clinic whenever I see. So I don't want to lose this from my brain because it's a beautiful chart. So I always depend on this to deliver the babies. So this is a typical textbook picture, what we have read in our PG. So this is when an abnormal uterine Doppler or uterine Dopplers are seen and normal umbilical Dopplers are seen. We go for weekly NSTs and weekly Dopplers. And in this, weekly Dopplers are being normal. We try to postpone till 37 and we can nicely deliver at 30th with either normal or C-sections, depending on the obstetric complications. If normal uterine Dopplers and abnormal umbilical Dopplers were there, weekly twice, bi-weekly NSTs has to be done and weekly umbilical and MCA Dopplers has to be done. So if it is decreased but greater than 1, we can deliver at 36 weeks. If it is less than 1 and normal ductus venosus, bi-weekly NSTs, and we can repeat the Dopplers, we'll try to postpone at least till 34 weeks and then deliver. But if any acidosis has developed or if the baby is it already reached, by this changes, if it is already reached 34 plus weeks, it's better to deliver. Both Dopplers are abnormal. So weekly NSTs, bi-weekly NSTs, and weekly umbilical arteries and MCAs as well as ductus venosus is included in the Doppler. If any reversal or interrupted flow in the ductus or any non-urgent NSTs like decreased variability, yes, irrespective of the age, we need to deliver immediately. So kind of, so how to decide about, the route of the deliveries, depending upon, it can be a vaginal delivery or it can be a C-sections. Well-matured babies greater than 37 weeks, we can give a trial with a very good surveillance. Like it is like intense surveillance has to be there in the labor room. And a high risk, any fetal distress or cord compression changes are being seen in the NSTs, we need to take the decision. Partogram has to be really maintained. It should not be a prolonged is like normal delivery, and continuous anesthesia, CTC machines has to be kept, and mother has to be kept in left lateral position with oxygen inflow, and very important thing is the neonatologist has to be available in hands in hospital. So C sections has to be done when prematurity is there, and if it is less than two, it, generally if the fetus is having the deranged Doppler, we have to take the decision about elective LSES. So finally, this IUGR is associated with high perinatal morbidity and mortality. Is important for obstetricians to recognize the fetus as risk of IUGRs. The foremost priority is to establish the rating criteria and further identify the modified risk factors and optimize the maternal systemic diseases. Thank you so much.
Ma'am, this is Dr. Kiran. Thank you so much for a wonderful, wonderful talk, ma'am. I think I have heard you before. Again, it's my pleasure to hear you again.
Thank you.
This topic is something which is usually not touched, ma'am. Gynecology, usually we go for all these PCOS and all these things. I mean, thank you so much for throwing a lot of light and being very practical as well.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Ma'am, with this help every obstetrician at least. It's a good discussion. Also, it was not boring.
I feel the audience also found it very interesting. So with this audience, you can ask the questions by typing in or asking ma'am directly by unmuting yourself. Ma'am, there are a few questions and comments which I'll read it out, ma'am.
Please, sir.
Ma'am, from Dr. Kishore Rajutkar from Delhi. See, he has a comment. He says, nowadays, ma'am, we are not dividing FGR in symmetrical and asymmetrical. And it's only divided as early and late. And he also goes on to say that definition of FGR should be made EFW less than 10th percentile plus Doppler change. And he says L arginine is not having any benefit. So that is his comment. And he wants to know, what is your opinion on OHT for oligohydramnios, ma'am?
I totally accept, sir. It's a very good question. To be frank, we are not dividing into symmetrical and asymmetrical. It's only thing is, both the things are divided only for the treatment sake, and which is an older one. Early and late, absolutely, I totally accept. But only to know the causes, I specially mentioned and have gone to the old definitions. And L-arginine, somehow, if you ask me personally, in my experience, sir, we are definitely seeing that, at least I won't promise any patient that you are going to improve your fluids or improve your condition. But at least I have seen lots of patients being maintained to the normal IUGRs. And when it comes to, sir, what was the last question, sir?
He wants to know your opinion on OHT for oligohydramnios.
Oral hypoglycemic drug, sir?
Yes,
what was that?
Yes. OHT is for oligohydramnios.
Oligohydramnios, I don't think so. It will be very helpful, sir. Very helpful, sir. But only in diabetic patients, if we keep the diabetes under control, at least they won't land up with polyhydramnios, or if it won't be overcorrected, mother can eat properly, because it's always a challenge for the patients and the doctors to maintain the weight in the diabetic patients. Mm-hmm. Even the same thing holds, to say, excess of OHTs we have never used, sir, to be frank. So generally, it is only useful for the gestational diabetic mothers.
Ma'am, a small clarification. Dr. Kishore clarifies, he meant oral hydration therapy.
Hydration therapy, okay. That's what I got confused. Hydration therapy is always a beautiful thing. Definitely it helps, sir. But only hydration with water, plain water, it may not be helpful. They need to be replaced with electrolytes. Because the composition of amniotic fluid, here we have to remember about composition of amniotic fluid. So depending on compositions, we depend more on proteins and electrolytes rather than the plain water. So when we counsel the patients, we need to ask them to go for either electrolyte powder depending on the conditions. Generally, homemade management, sir. So, and in treatment, it is always written, sir. Oral hydration therapy is very important.
Ma'am, the next question is from Dr. B.S. Geeta. She wants to know, is there any role of
as such we are not using infusion? Madam, because there is no even RCOG, recent RCOGs and ACOGs have proven it is not much helpful by giving the infusions. Rather than the sachets, what we are giving along with the magnesium is better, because pure alumin infusions are not being used nowadays, madam. No updates were given in that. I totally accept when we are studying, when it was it is like an old protocol, but not very much proven results were seen, madam. It was clearly given in the guidelines of RCOGs. No infusions have been included in it recently.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question and comment is again from Dr. Rajul Kura. I'll first read the comment. He tells, early FGR less than 32 weeks, late FGR more than 32 weeks. CPR is the most important ratio, better than MCI and UVA taken alone. He wants to know, do you give importance to biophysical score in the decision of termination?
Sorry, sir. Do you give importance to? I could not hear. Biophysical? Yes.
Ma'am, he wants to know, keeping this in mind, do you give importance to biophysical score in taking a decision of termination?
So, yes, sir. To be frank, I will give you an example of a case which I got experienced. She is an elderly female, 35 years old, conceived with IVF. And that patient, since 32 weeks, always in her biophysical profile, it is always being scored in between 4 to 6 only. But her Doppler is being normal. So we tried to postpone. We admitted the patient because we don't want to ignore that biophysical profile. So we admitted that because that's a very rare case. I could not forget the case also. And we monitored every week. We gave steroids, we gave magnesium sulfate, we monitored almost alternate days the profile being monitored, keeping the patient at hospital. Still the profile is not getting improved in spite of hydrating her, in spite of giving arginines, in spite of whatever the, even she's not having any maternal complications, or she's non-diabetic, non-hypertensive. And taking that consultations, we have delivered the patient at 34 to 35 weeks after taking 4 to 5 opinions from the gynecologist, sir. So that was a very rare condition which we can see. But yes, we have to take the biophysical profile into the consultations. If it is less than 6, please try to consider. Better not to ignore the biophysical profile in spite of the Doppler's being normal.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, I had a question from my side,
please,
ma'am.
Sir.
With your permission. I'm not a gynecologist, but ma'am, actually, if you have any of these pre-existing conditions like diabetes or GDM,
sir.
Does that suppose you? I have a case scenario, ma'am. You have a lady who's around 34, 35, and has conceived, and she's got this borderline GDM and all these things.
Okay.
They have more chances of developing IUGR, ma'am?
That, sir, if it, here, as we discussed, it's a challenge, sir. If we keep the sugars under control and take the required calories which are sufficient for the mother according to the BMI, IUGR may not occur. If the diabetes is being not corrected properly, I mean, sometimes we see macrosemic babies as well as IUGR babies. I mostly see in my practice or practically, or even it is written in the studies, mother will be overcorrecting along with the diet, lack of proteins. She'll be thinking that I should not take tablets, I should manage with diet. Overcorrection of diet sometimes land up with IUGR, sir. And second thing is uncontrolled diabetes, which is very badly under control. Yes, reversely, it may cause uteroplacental insufficiency, increased placental maturation. We discussed in the talk also. That may land up with IUGRs. So it is always a challenge to balance both, sir.
And ma'am, if you have a combination of preeclampsia and gestational diabetes, would you, as a preventive measure, start the patient on L-arginine or aspirin?
Yes, or perfectly. It will. Yeah, we have to, sir, because both are good for magnesium sulfate and L-arginine, or both are good. Because in preeclampsia, we see more endothelial damage. So, and endothelial damage because of lack of nitric oxide synthetase, and L-arginine will usually induce all those things and helpful. It is very helpful for that.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is from Dr. Suri Devi Thangavel. She wants to know what is the dose of magnesium sulfate, and if it is to be started, then for how long, ma'am?
if it is like oral, sir, madam is asking about the general oral preparation which was given prior, or it is like to prevent intraventricular hemorrhage, sir, for the neuroprotection.
She is asking about the dose of magnesium sulfate or how long.
Okay. So magnesium sulfate, usually combinations we are getting is like 200 milligrams per day. Daily, it is a very good doses to prevent this. And we are having lots of combinations, madam. Like we are getting tablets also along with normal iron and calcium combinations. Nowadays, we are getting calcium and magnesium combinations also we are getting. 200 milligrams is more than enough. We have to start it second trimester, continue till the delivery. And if it is like neuroprotection, it is like an injections. We usually give the loading dose as we give it in the preeclampsia, like 4 grams IV, stat doses, followed by 1 gram per hour for 24 hours, depending upon the condition. If in case ongoing labor is going on, we continue till the till almost 8 to 9 centimeters of normal delivery and then stop it to prevent the PPHs. And in case if it is C-section, preferably according to recent RCOG protocol, before the surgery also it can be taken. But practically, if we stop before 2 hours before the surgery, we can see the beautiful results. We can prevent the PPHs also.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, actually, Dr. Suridhi clarifies that the previous question was in relation for IUGR.
IUGRs.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what. Yeah, that is like tablets for calcium and magnesium combination tablets, 200 milligrams plus 1 gram calcium, which can be given from second trimester till delivery, sir.
Ma'am, she thanks you for a beautiful explanation for the question.
Thank you, madam.
There is a comment from Dr. Kishore. He says if the Dopplers are normal, then it is not FGR.
But if it is weight is less than when we compare even the low birth weight and as well as the IUGRs, the definition itself shows though Dopplers are normal and if it is smaller, it is called as an IUGR, sir, according to the definition.
Thank you, ma'am.
The Dopplers are only for indicate according to the obstetricians' experiences, Dopplers are as for us is it's an indication, it's a predictor for us to whether how to manage the manage that fetus intrauterine.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question is from Dr. B. S. Geeta. She wants to know, is there any role of IV fluids like 10% dextrose?
Dextrose therapy.
Yes, ma'am.
Definitely, it is not much useful, madam, because dextrose, hyperglycemic conditions do occur and if the mother is having any hypoglycemic episode secondary to that, we can give as a first line treatment. But as such, rather than dextrose, aluminum infusions are better. See, I might be contradicting the RCOG protocols, but IV fluids, plain IV fluids, and nowadays we are getting this plasmolite, which is rich of magnesium. So we usually go for preeclampsia, we are going for plasmolites. Rather than dextrose, we can go for plasmolites, madam.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question is from Dr. Lalita Krishna Kumar. She wants to know what is the treatment of oligohydramnios in IUGR, ma'am?
Oligohydramnios in IUGR. Madam, here the role is only LH9 and high protein diet and
hydration.
Chitra, can you mute everyone except me and ma'am?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So we are going towards oligohydramnios treatment in IUGR. So definitely here the arginine plays the role and hydration and high protein diet is only the things which we can do, madam. As such, infusions and see amniotic infusions or any intra-amniotic infusions are still in the experimental levels. It's not like no one is doing. Yes, we are seeing the good results. But depending upon the, when we diagnose it early, and early replacement of hydration, left lateral position rest, high proteins, and LH9 will solve the problem, madam.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, Dr. Kishore has a comment, ma'am, in continuation to his Doppler comment. He tells, the Doppler has to be abnormal for definition of FGR. If only weight is less, it is SGA and not FGR.
We can, sir, but yeah, maybe, sir, even I will upgrade when I have to see that RCOG and ACOG's definitions again. Even today before coming, I have checked it. I didn't see, but definitely I'll recorrect myself, sir. I'll check it out once again, for sure.
Very good discussion, ma'am, actually.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Ma'am, the next question is from Dr. Milan, ma'am. He wants to know IUGR and the patient is lean and thin diabetic. What do we do?
Lean and thin diabetic, type 2 diabetes. So yes. Type 2 diabetes, yes, sir, we usually see. That's all depends upon the placental insufficiency we already discussed. So either any diabetic patients, any PCOD patients who are not been detected with gestational diabetes, the IUGR causes is really less. But PCOD women who are landing up with gestational diabetes, which is usually we see in our practices more than 50%, and we will be very overconscious, and early GTTs also we will be doing in our practices for PCOD women. Definitely, if it is early onset of diabetes in first trimester or second trimester, we usually see IUGR babies, sir. But here the obstetrician role plays a lot. We need to counsel them a lot to balance between the diabetic control and their diet. And the placental maturation has to be checked very frequently. I mean, whatever the 3 weekly scans we are doing for IUGRs, we have to have an eye on placental maturation, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question is from Dr. B.S. Geeta. She wants to know your opinion on treatment in polyhydramnios.
Polyhydramnios.
Yes,
ma'am. Polyhydramnios, definitely we always see unknown causes. Idiopathic causes were always, unknown causes were always there, madam. So, but any polyhydramnios, generally, we need to first rule any other complications like GI complications and renal complications in the fetus. If anomaly scan was not showing any of the abnormalities, we need to check first the gestational diabetes of the mother. Any gestational diabetes conditions in the mother. So we need to check their sugars depending upon the trimester. And if the sugars being controlled, we can definitely control the polyhydramnios. If we detect the polyhydramnios at around second trimester, definitely we can control it by reducing the diet. So if we improve the diet with only rich proteins and low calories, maybe around 300 kilocalories, if we reduce them for the daily requirements, polyhydramnios can be treated. And in case if it is ongoing polyhydramnios, in spite of taking all the precautions, no gestational diabetes, unknown reasons, if it is really greater than 20, then fetal monitoring is very important. And fetal monitoring with the same like NSTs, Dopplers, maybe once in 15 days. I usually do once in 15 days AFI Dopplers, once in 3 weeks the gestation growth scan plus Dopplers again. And we'll try to pull the pregnancy till 37 weeks. And I have delivered almost 23 to 25 AFIs also. We can deliver them normally with high survivalence during the labor. So medications, as we know, that's an entire different scenarios for polyhydramnios, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. One more question from Dr. Kishore. He wants to know, do you give endomethazine for
polyhydramnios. So recent RCOG protocols have not given the endomethazine tablets, sir, in that. But yes, we have seen the differences. As such, now we are not giving any endomethazine because they have very bad effects on the pulmonary issues as well as intraventricular hemorrhages has occurred in few studies they have shown, sir. It got occurred in the fetus. So at present, it's not given, sir. We are not using.
Any more questions, doctor? Ma'am, there is one comment from Dr. B.S. Geeta, ma'am.
Sir.
Yes, ma'am. She agrees with you. She tells advising to have cut off what only sugar has given good results in many patients.
Yeah, maybe cutting off sugars only has given good results to my patients. Yeah, ma'am is sharing her experience, sir. She's telling that if any, I think I can see the message here.
Yes, ma'am.
Hope that I'm right. If madam is also saying cutting off the sugar, like high calories to the obstetric, I mean, any female with polyhydramnia, madam is seeing very good results. Same with me, madam. It is really helping us if we counsel them regarding the diet.
Ma'am, the next comment is from Dr. Vishnu. He says, very nice presentation, ma'am. And he compliments you for the presentation. And he tells, our aim should be to differentiate SGA and FGR so that preterms are not delivered.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for the compliment, sir. Definitely, we have to differentiate between SGA and fetal growth restrictions. There are prematurity and dismaturity. Both we have to take into the considerations and we need to take the decision for delivery. Thank you so much, sir.
Ma'am, Dr. Geeta, thank you for a wonderful explanation.
Thank you, madam. Thank you so much.
So I think with no further questions, ma'am, we will bring the session to the close. Thank you so much once again from on behalf of Shield Healthcare and the audience also. I think we had a very wonderful presentation as well as a very, very good discussion, ma'am. I think you were very clear in answering the questions and thank you so much once again, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Kiran sir, for giving me opportunity for the Shield people also. And thanks for the discussions for all the doctors. Hope it's a healthy discussion for us. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We want to have many more webinars in the future, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Same here. Will be pleasure. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
See you, sir. Bye.
Bye.